Hello everyone, thank you so much for joining us for another Conservation Conversations webinar. Today we'll be talking about all things batty with Susan Holroyd, the Calgary Community Coordinator for the Alberta Community Bat Program. So without further ado, I will pass things off to Susan to get this webinar started.
Hello everyone, and thank you for coming out today to listen about bats. I work with the Alberta Community Bat Program. It's a program that's only been around for the last 4 years. Our mothership nonprofit organization is the Wildlife Conservation Society Canada. So we're a sub-program of them. And we have a few coordinators. We're not a large organization, but everybody is who's associated with the program right now has all done research on bats or graduate degrees on bats. So yes, we're a qualified bunch, but not a lot of us. Okay, so I'm gonna just go to my presentation now. All right, so I'd like to include everything. Anyway, I did my master's degree at the University of Calgary in the early 90s. I worked as a consultant downtown. I worked with the BC government as a regional wildlife biologist for several years. I've been involved in writing best management practices guidebooks for BC, and I've done independent consulting since coming back to Alberta in 2001. And in the last 4 years, I've been working with the Community Bat Program. So I've spent over the past 25 more years. I've always been dabbling in bats, and I did do my graduate degree on bats in Alberta. So, and I've done lots of inventory and stuff on bats. So had lots of bat experience. I live in Calgary, and I have 3 kids, and one of them is off at university now, and the other 2 are still home. So yes, it's busy life here. So the program objectives, the Alberta Community Bat Program was put together really in response to the white nose syndrome infection that arose in 2006 in North America. The province saw that bats were gonna be in trouble, and they wanted to put together a program that would help with bat conservation because there really wasn't a lot that was being done. The main objective is really to put together a program that would somehow facilitate population monitoring, which is our citizen science project, which I'm going to talk about. But it's also to do outreach and to educate Albertans about bats so that they put them on their radar as a conservation concern. And just so that we can all do a little bit to help build resilience in the bat populations. So when they're forced to deal with the threats that are coming, that hopefully we can get through it and still have populations that can recover. So yes, outreach is a big part of the program. Normally we would be going to schools and talking to school kids, but we do events we have a pretty strong social media presence as well. The big part is the citizen science, that's the public stewardship component. We also have resources that we've developed that are available online, and we participated in a few different monitoring programs as well. So some of the resources that we have available are on our website. These are all recent publications that we've put together, and we keep updating them as well as we get more information on some of these things. So the big one that a lot of people use is this Managing Bats and Buildings Guidebook. I didn't turn on my favorite thing, which is the laser pointer. There we go. So the Managing Bats and Buildings Guidebook is a big one because a lot of homeowners have bats in their buildings and they want to know what to do. And at least our recommendations support a bat-friendly way of managing bats in buildings. Bat houses are a big thing now. Everybody wants to build a bat house. This guidebook tells you about how to install and the type of bat house that you might want to build. And we also provide free plans for bat houses that you can build. And our most recent publication is this Building Bat-Friendly Communities Guidebook. And it has species background information for Alberta bats. as well as it talks about hazards that might exist in your backyard that would affect bats, things like lighting and rain barrels and cats. And then it also talks about what you can do to improve habitat in your backyard for bats. And a lot of that actually is helpful for aerial insectivores as well, because it's all about creating food resources, which means planting native plants and maybe providing a freshwater source or like a small pond, and what kind of a pond or water source a bat would need. And it varies depending on the species, and we talk about that in this program guide. So the other things that we're working on currently, we're working on a brochure for pest controllers, because the pest controllers often get called when they have to deal with managing bats in buildings. And we're trying to encourage bat-friendly management. We also are working on a brochure for the farming community, a bat-friendly farming brochure. And we have been building up resources for educators that we do have some things available. If people contact us, we're happy to share those things. So the Citizen Science Project, it basically involves homeowners or people with bat houses who they then report their bat roost, and that could be a natural roost or a bat roost in a building or a bat house. They can go online, and we have all the instructions and bat data sheets. You fill out where you are, and then a couple of times early in the season and then later in the season, you just go out for an hour as the sun sets and you watch your bats coming out of your bat roost and you count them, and then you just send us the data. So we've got quite good uptake from sort of the corridor of Calgary to Edmonton. We're slowly building more reporting from little corners of the province. We'd like to get a little bit more reporting across the province, though. The little purple triangles are the little brown bats. The green squares are big brown bats. And the white circles, the big ones, are species that we know there's someone has reported on their bat roost, but they haven't told us what species, because they didn't send us some bat guano. So we get people to send us little paper envelopes with about a spoonful of bat poop in it. Yeah, it's an odd request. You go, please send us bat poop. But we can do DNA analysis on the bat guano, and you can get species from feces. So that's always exciting. So we've had 4 years of data now, and it's been slowly growing. Now, and we have a whole protocol for collecting guano too. So that's all on our website. So if anybody wants to participate, all the instructions are on our website. We encourage anyone who has a bat house or a roost to submit. The other thing that we're kind of looking for is people who have just put up a bat house, just to keep reporting, even if they don't have any bats. Zeros count, because we want to see how long it takes for those bat houses to become occupied as well. So it would be nice if people were reporting that as well. So the outcomes from this Citizen Science Project is that it'll give us won't tell us how many bats are out there, but it will give us an index of population sizes. So if the populations start to decrease, we'll be able to see that in the bat house monitoring data. So you'd expect that if overwintering bats are affected, they're not going to show up in maternity boxes. So you'll see this crash, but that hasn't happened yet. But we're still monitoring. The other part is that there's this larger program of monitoring, bat monitoring, called the North American Bat Monitoring Program, that our primary biologist with Wildlife Conservation Society Canada, Corey Lawson, was involved in the team that put together this program. And it's across North America, and it's using acoustic information to try to do the same thing as sort of monitor bat populations. This is sort of across species. Our program, because big browns and little browns are the primary ones using those buildings and bat houses, the data is from those roost counts, basically, is focused on those two species, whereas the acoustic monitoring is all species. But the idea is that the NABAT will use our data as well, so we'll it'll get shipped in to help sort of look at those trends of population. It's kind of like the backyard bird count for bats, which has been really successful, that backyard bird count, in looking at species populations. So we're hoping that we can get the same kind of data set for bats. We're also hoping we're going to get improved building management and better habitat enhancement guidelines from our monitoring. And there's potential for looking at treatment options for white-nose syndrome. So why are we worried about bats? And why is it a conservation concern? Now, most people think of bats as, you know, your typical small mammal. That they're like a mouse. And in a few languages, they indeed are called mouse. Like the Fledermausen is the flying mouse in German, or the chauve-souris, which is shaved mouse in French. But that's pretty much where the similarity ends. A typical small mammal, they live a couple of years. They have large litter sizes. They may have 2 or 3 litters in a summer. So their populations can fluctuate quite rapidly, and they can increase quite rapidly. Now, what I keep telling people is, what I want you to think about when you think of bats is a tiny flying grizzly bear, because they're really more like a grizzly bear than they are a mouse, and that they only have a single pup each year, most species. Some species will give birth to twins, but most of them only give birth to one. They're large pups. They can be up to 30% of the mother's body weight at birth. They have high overwinter mortality in their first couple of winters. They lose 40 to 50% of pups just over the winter. Hibernation is really difficult. But they can live a very long time. And we actually have a North American longevity record for little browns of 39 years. They found a banded bat in Cadman Cave that had been banded 39 years previously. The average lifespan is probably 25 to 30 for a little brown bat, which is pretty crazy when you think of an animal that's only weighs 7 grams. So the result of that life history strategy is that when you lose a population, it takes a long time for them to build back again. So if you lose a colony, it actually has a huge impact on the local populations. So they really are a conservation concern. So in Alberta, we have more than just the bat, which a lot of people just refer to bats and they lump them all together, which drives bat biologists crazy. But we have 9 species in Alberta, and 3 of them, this guy, the silver-haired bat, the hoary bat, and the red bat, these are the 3 migratory species. And then the other 6, this is the western small-footed, long-legged, big brown, little brown, northern myotis, and the long-eared myotis. These 2 are both long-eared bats in the corner here. Those are 9 species. Now, soon they're all going to be listed in some way, I'm pretty sure, because of various threats on bat populations. Some of them, like this guy, the long-legged myotis, he always comes up data deficient. Nobody knows much about him, so they don't really have an idea what their true status is. And even like federally, they're called data deficient. And in Alberta, they don't classify them because they don't have enough data. These 2, the long-eared myotis and the big brown bat, Alberta, they call them secure. But this big brown bat is experiencing up to 50, 60% mortality because of white-nose syndrome. But because it's so much lower than the other 2 that have been federally listed, they haven't really decided that this one's at risk. But, you know, if this was the only one that they were looking at and it had 50% mortality, I'm sure they would label it as at risk. But right now they're calling it secure. And these guys, this long-eared myotis, is a Western species, and it hasn't really encountered white-nose syndrome yet. So we're not exactly sure how it's going to affect their populations. Now, these 2 species, the little brown and the northern myotis, have been significantly impacted by white-nose syndrome, and they're currently listed as species at risk in Alberta, and they're listed as endangered species federally. So under SARA, they're listed as endangered. And that was 2014 they got listed. Now the three migratory species, the silver, the hoary bat, and the red bats, because of their migratory habits, are at risk because of wind turbines. And we're really quite concerned about hoary bats across their distribution in North America. They're concerned that we could have extinction in less than 90 years. And the estimates were based on development of wind turbines a few years ago, and wind turbine development has increased rapidly since that paper was put out where they did this population estimate. So it could be within 50 years, if we don't do something, we're losing a lot of hoary bats. And Alberta, actually, silver-haired bats they're the ones that are most likely to be killed at wind turbine sites. And we don't have really good estimates of population of any of these bats. The last little bat that here is the western small-footed myotis, which is listed as a sensitive species in Alberta because of its restricted distribution. It's just found in the grasslands along the river valleys. It's totally cute, because it's just not that common, they've listed it. So why do we care anyway? Well, they have done some calculations of how economically important bats are. They're ecologically important, but they're also economically important. Some of the calculations from the US, they were up to $53 billion a year in pest control, the value of what bats do every night all summer. The average was like $23 billion a year. There was a biologist from Toronto who tried to come up with a similar estimate. It was based just on number of hectares and how many bats we have. And their estimate for Canada was something like $15 billion a year. So, I mean, these bats are eating moths, beetles, biting flies, mosquitoes, other insects, and they can eat their way to insects in a night. So they definitely are having an impact on insect populations. And this estimate of their value in insect control was only for agriculture. It didn't look at farming or farming for cattle, and it didn't look at forestry either. So they're both of those industries also deal with trying to control insects. So the migratory bats, I had to put this picture in because it's one of my favorite ones. Just shows you just how pretty they are. Most bats, people think of them as a small little black or little brown flying creatures, but here you've got red bats and they are brilliantly red. The hoary bats, which his nickname is the skyline because it has this yellow ruff around his face. And then the silver-haired bats with these black coats with these silvery tips. Now these two are solitary bats. So they roost as single bats high up in the canopy and they roost off of teeny tiny twigs. And these guys they form small colonies, the silver-haired bats, and they will use things like woodpecker holes or holes in trees that they can find. And all three of these leave Alberta every year. Although this one, we keep getting reports in the wintertime from wood piles. So we're not sure if they do hang around. Like a few of them hang around in Alberta, but there's some indication that they actually head into British Columbia or they head south. And then we figure they migrate and then hibernate. These two, we figure, go as far as maybe the southern US, Mexico, could be as far as Central America, we're not sure. And they probably stay active year round. Now the hibernating species, the six that we have, I'm just going to go through them a little bit, their ecology and their life history. So the big brown is a fairly common species, and you can tell big browns because of their faces. They've got these big bulby faces with the bare skin. And they call them big, but they're twice the size of a little brown. They're still small. Whenever people report bats, they always tell us they found a baby bat, but it's not, they're just small. Big browns will roost in houses, roost in rock crevices, and in trees. And like I said, they're considered secure in Alberta. But and right now, most our bats aren't affected by white nose syndrome. So they all reflect that we haven't had the fungus here yet. So Alberta still considers all our populations secure. So this would be like a rock crevice that you might find a big brown in. This one actually was also used by Western small-footed myotis, so they use that kind of a habitat too. Little brown myotis, like I said, are listed as endangered in Canada. In the east, the hibernation sites where there are large caves where they had lots of bats hibernating, they were getting 90 to 95% mortality. So they were losing a lot of bats. And again, buildings, roost, rock crevices, and trees. And then this is the other one, the northern long-eared bat. They were getting up to 98% mortality. They're actually concerned about extinction for this species. It's always been listed as a maybe at risk in Alberta because of its dependence on trees. It's forestry dependent and likes old trees. And then this guy, there's a quarter down here. That's how much he weighs. He's only like 4 grams. They're blonde little bats with black mask and black ears. They're super cute and considered sensitive in Alberta. And this is what I said, this restricted distribution. There's the Milk River, South Saskatchewan, and Red Deer, and that's where you find them, is in this purple area. This is sort of typical habitat. This is dry island buffalo jump. And they roost in the erosion crevices in these riverbanks. And you can see there's these holes, and some of them go back a meter, and that's where these little bats are hiding. Big browns are found in these kind of habitats as well. So we monitor bats using with bat detectors. These are kind of more expensive broadband detectors that detect multiple species at once. This little guy you can buy now as a non-professional model. It's only about $175. And you can turn your phone or your tablet into a bat detector, which will give you, this is just a fancy microphone. It picks up the ultrasound, and it will give you the sonogram. It will give you the audio of the bat because it brings the echolocation call down to a frequency we can hear. And it has an auto ID program, so it'll tell you what species you're listening to, which is pretty cool. And if we go out on a bat walk, I have a set of these and we can share them and people can look at them. So if you want to turn up your speakers a little bit, you can listen. This is what you would get from one of those bat detectors, the output. Different species echolocate at different frequencies. And this is the little brown bats have a higher voice than big brown bats. So this is big browns and little browns echolocating. And if you listen, you can hear a high chirp and a low chirp. So it's kind of cool. We can't hear that at night because we can't hear high frequency sound. But your dogs and cats can hear that. So if you're walking your dog at night and it's staring at the sky, it's because it's hearing that chirpy noise. It's hearing bats echolocating over its head. And bats are really loud. When they're echolocating, they can be as loud as 120 decibels, which is like the sound level at a rock concert. So they're really loud for such small mammals. It's amazing they can make sound that loud. Now, white nose syndrome is what I've been talking about, and it's caused by a fungus that was introduced from Europe in 2006. It started in eastern New York State, and it has been spreading by bat to bat across North America. What happens is when they first saw it, it was growing on the bat's noses. That's why it's called white nose syndrome, but it grows on the bat's wings, and it can actually eat through the wing membrane. It causes water loss. It wakes them up in the middle of winter. It only affects them in the hibernation site. What happens is the fungus itself doesn't kill them. It wakes them up and it uses up their fat reserves, and the bats actually starve to death. This is what they were finding in the east in these big colonies of hibernating bats. It's these big piles of bats dead on the floor of the hibernation sites. So the estimate is about 10 million bats that we've lost. It's probably much higher than that. They've lost count because the fungus has moved into areas where we really don't know where hibernation sites are. And in the West, we really don't know where our bats hibernate. So it might be that we do know of them in a few small caves, but it's small numbers. And we think they might be using rock crevices, but we're really not sure how this fungus is going to affect our populations just because of the difference in hibernation habitat. So this is the spread map. And if you want to go to whitenosesyndrome.org, You can read all about white nose syndrome. This is Upper New York State where it started in 2006, and every year is a different color. 2016, it jumped and it went to Seattle. I think a bat got a ride in a camper or a transport truck. And so it's about 100 kilometers from the BC border now. And it just means that we've got bat, it's in Riding Mountain National Park. They actually detected the fungal spores this past spring in northern Montana, right about here. So it's only a few years before it's actually going to make it to Alberta. So then we're going to be watching closely to see what's going to happen to our bats. We're not sure. So WCS Canada and Thompson River University we've been working with them, and we've been swabbing healthy bats and getting naturally occurring fungi and bacteria off the wings of healthy bats. And they've extracted those fungi and they've grown them in petri dishes and in introduced the invasive fungus, and some of the naturally occurring ones will actually kill off the introduced fungus. So what they've done is they've created like a powder substance, a probiotic. And we did do a test where they applied it to a maternity roost in southern BC and the lower mainland. And the idea was is to try to boost their immunity so that they would be able to survive fungal infections. But then COVID hit and we weren't allowed to actually catch bats. So they were going to check on the bats this past spring. We're going to have to wait for another season and maybe next spring be able to capture some bats and see what's going on, if they still have higher levels of the good fungi on their wings when they come out of hibernation. That might mean that we have a chance to at least help our bats a bit. So the other big way of helping out bats is we have a bat calendar that we ask people to observe. So if they're doing exclusions or work on houses, there's a time when you should not be working on your roost or your building or whatever. So from June to September is when you have bat moms and pups in big colonies that might be in buildings. So if you're going to do exclusions or any kind of renovation, to try to keep your construction in the rest of the year. So it's a timing window issue. And that's one of our biggest mitigation measures that we try to advocate. And then bat houses, people are mad about bat houses these days. The single chamber bats houses, we've been telling people to not put up, or if you do put them up, put them in a cool location. They tend to overheat. And we actually had some bat deaths in our bat houses. So these are different models of bat houses. This is the one this four chamber nursery box is the one we tell most people to build if they want to build one. And we're between British Columbia and Alberta, we've got different people with studies putting temperature monitors and relative humidity sensors in different bat house models. And we're trying to figure out what's the best design. We're kind of where birdhouses were 50 years ago. So we've got a lot to learn about bat houses. But basically they should be about 3 meters high, south facing or east facing, kind of with a flyway because bats drop and fly out of the bottom box. People are always asking us where to put them and how to put them up. And we have, that's the bat house guidebook that is available on our website, has all this information. Sometimes they put those four chamber boxes up back to back too, which is good. You need about 300 bats in each one of these boxes, so you can house a lot. And people ask about rabies too. The incidence of rabies in the free-flying population is less than a half of 1%, so it's quite rare. But because rabies is a fatal disease, we always say that if you've had any bearskin contact with a bat, is just go and get your rabies shots. Now they're just little shots in the arm. They're quite effective, and it's a way to stay safe. But the best way to stay safe is just don't handle bats. You have to be bitten. It's the saliva that transfers the virus. So if you have no touch, there's really no risk. And bat guano is not a risk to human health. But we always say to be cautious, because if you're cleaning up an attic or something, you might have mouse guano mixed in, and they're really hard to tell apart. So these are some of the people some of the groups that have been funding us over the past 4 years. The Edmonton Foundation and the Calgary Foundation have been very generous in the last 2 years. and Alberta Conservation Association, EcoTrust, and the Alberta government, and a few other places that have supported us. And that's our social media connection, which we're quite active on social media too. So, yeah. So that's my talk. If we have time, I probably went late, but if you want to have any questions, I'm willing to stay around.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Susan. We are at the 12:30 mark. So if anyone has to jump off, we will be sending out the recording after this email, or after in a later date. Thank you so much for attending. If you have to leave, if you do have any questions and you want to stay on, like Susan said, we're happy to keep chatting bats. Susan had so much information and we had asked her to condense it into a small presentation. So thank you so much, Susan. If you do have any questions, there is just a reminder, a chat box. So if you look at the bottom of your screen, it should be in the middle of the icons. It says chat. It might have a little notification. You can click on that and then just put your question in there. So we already have a couple of questions. People are very excited. So the first one, perhaps someone was wondering about Alberta bats as pollinators of plants. So could you maybe specifically speak to Alberta ecosystems and how bats act as pollinators if they do?
Not in Alberta. So all of our bats are insect eaters. There are some pollinators that live in North America. There's one that's key in pollinating the agave plants, which is used to make tequila. So if you like tequila, you have to be a bat fan. But those are the lesser and greater long-nosed bats. They range into the southern U.S. and in Mexico. So that's where they are. Although we do have a bat in the South Okanagan, the pallid bat, that has been known to pollinate saguaro cactus, but all in the southern part of the range. They found them nose deep in those big flowers sucking out nectar. So they inadvertently, they normally eat insects, but they must have been watching the other guys and said, hey, that looks good. So most of the pollinators tend to be tropical. Yeah.
Awesome. Perfect. And then we had a bat house specific question. So is it possible to set up a bat house in inner city of Calgary or perhaps even any urban center? Is a bat house appropriate?
Actually, that's where we say they are most appropriate, because really you shouldn't be setting up a bat house to replace for forestry, say. It's like that's not a management a method that we would advocate. Forestry should be managing to maintain snags and, you know, and green tree recruitment to have older age class trees. But in urban areas where we've cut down trees, and we don't have a lot of older trees, which would be the natural roosting habitat for bats, then putting up bat houses is a substitute and provides an alternate roost location for those bats. So they're totally appropriate within any of the urban centers. Yeah.
Perfect. Thank you. And then there was another question. Someone listening mentioned that there are studies where wind turbines, one blade of the turbine has been painted, and that has been shown to reduce bird fatalities. So our listener was wondering, are there any instances like that where maybe they're using like a sonic device or a sonic emitter to scare away bats from wind turbines, or any studies that are focused on bat fatalities in wind turbines?
Yeah, so, you know, 1990 was when I was at U of C, and they were just starting to do research on wind energy and bats, and because they realized it was a problem. They're still working on it. So they have got a few different mitigation methods that they put in place. They can change the angle of the blades. It's called feathering. That seems to reduce mortality a little bit. The best method they have is during, there's a 6-week window when the bats are moving from north to south, and that's when the most mortality happens. So in that 6-week window, when you have nights with low wind speed and warm temperatures, that seems to be when most of the bats are moving, and they can actually lock those rotors in place overnight. So when they do that, they have a significant decrease in the number of bats that they kill. The other thing is, I mean, they try to put it in places where bats don't fly, but we really don't know that much about migration. So they've been really bad about figuring that out. The other complication is there's a couple of things with hoary bats, especially, is that when they're migrating, they don't seem to echolocate. So they're not using echolocation to figure out their route. They must be using stars or some kind of magnetic field kind of thing. And they mate, they travel in flocks when they move from north to south. And they think that's when the mating occurs. And these bats seem to be attracted to large trees on the landscape, and the male and female will chase each other around the tree. And they think that when they see those big turbines on the landscape, especially on the prairies, to them it just looks like a big tree. So they're flying in and flying around it, thinking it's a big tree and look like it's actually attracting bats. They have been working on the ultrasonic emitters. That is work that's still ongoing, and haven't heard whether they've had any success with that or not. I would be curious, like I'm a little skeptical about that, because I know, especially with little brown bats, if one hits the net and they're squawking ultrasonically, it attracts all their friends because they all come in and go, "What's the matter?" And they all hit the net at the same time. So the ultrasound might actually attract bats. That's my feeling, but they're, like I said, the study's still out.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you. And then we have a lot of questions about bat boxes. So just looking here. So one question is, should people also be installing baby bat catchers? I'm not sure what those are, but
that's someone who's done their homework. Yes, they call them pup catchers. So sometimes what people will do is a couple meters below the box, they'll build a little tray with a mesh. So it's like a frame with the mesh in the bottom, and it sticks out underneath if it's on a post or under a building, so that if a baby drops out of the bat house, it gets caught and then it can climb its way back up again, or the mom can come down and pick it up and haul it back up into the bat house, because sometimes they do drop. Yeah, you definitely could put one in. I would use the screen material underneath to catch them, and then because it won't trap water, so you won't actually create a little puddle underneath them. They could be also useful because they catch poop. So if you're not sure if your bat house is being used, you can check it and see if there's bat guano in it as well. So yeah. Definitely something you could add on.
Perfect. And then another question on the bat boxes. Are there references on perhaps your website or somewhere to look for folks who sell and build the bat boxes and sell them? People are keen on bats now. Where can they get their boxes?
Yeah, you have to. Okay, so if you wanted to build one yourself, we always recommend the 4-chamber nursery box, and the plans are online. It's about $35 to $45 worth of material. And if you have someone who has some old plywood laying around, you can scavenge some materials, so you can build it fairly cheaply, but you have to kind of know your way around a saw. There are a couple of places. The Wild Bird Store in South Calgary has some builders that they commission to build bat houses, and they have some good ones. But just when you're buying, just watch that you get a multi-chamber box. It's best if they actually score the wood and don't have the screen on the interior panels, because sometimes the screen will pull away and it can trap baby bats in there, and it also can trap guano, so then you have to actually have more maintenance. I think the Kerrywood Nature Center in Red Deer sells some. I know DNA Gardens in Elnora, it's a little fruit stand type little pick berry place. They have some for $85, and they're the big 4-chamber boxes. They're well built. Yeah, you can buy them online, but some places they charge quite a bit of money for them, and then you have to charge for shipping too. So yeah, you have to look around. They keep popping up. I think Canadian Tire and stuff has them, but you have to watch, because sometimes they'll be selling like a single chamber box, and we tell people to avoid those, because we've been looking at them with the temperature sensors, and some of them were over 60 degrees Celsius in the sun. So that's way too hot for baby bats. They die from overheating.
Yeah. Yeah. And then if folks were looking to install a bat box, say in the spring, and maybe forget a little bit because this webinar is happening in September, is all this information in the bat box guide on your website?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Perfect.
Yeah. And feel free, if you follow us on Facebook, you can always message us too if you want to ask a question.
Awesome. And then we have folks listening from all over Canada, actually. So someone from Newfoundland and someone from Ontario. If folks are looking for information on initiatives in their own province or area, do you have a suggestion of where to look, perhaps?
So I would look, I know Newfoundland and Labrador, there is a bat, community bat program that they've been trying to put together with their provincial government. But if you check out batwatch.ca, Batwatch is sort of based out of Ontario and Quebec, but they're sort of, it's sort of like our citizen science project, but nationwide. And all we have our own Alberta program. We actually export some of our data into their program as well. So they map out bat boxes across North America, or across Canada. British Columbia has the most active community bat program. And Ontario has a program too that's run out of the Toronto Zoo. I'm not sure, I think Quebec is active, but I'm not sure what their community bat program looks like. And I don't know about the other Atlantic provinces. I know that there's people that are doing stuff for bats, but they don't have the specific bat community bat program in place.
Certainly.
But I'll answer questions if you ask me. I could probably help you out. So.
Perfect. We will be sharing contact information for Susan at the end. So if people have more specific questions that they feel more comfortable asking her one-on-one, that is certainly an option as well.
Yeah. Well, I'm the social media coordinator too. So
yes,
if you do message, you get me. So most of the time. So
that's always nice to know. You never know who's on the other end, but
yeah,
you know, it's Susan now. To the social
there's only a couple of us. So yeah, we wear many hats.
That's amazing. Perfect. And then we had another question. So for folks who want to do things to help the populations, are there any things that we shouldn't be doing or should avoid doing to help bat populations?
The cats are probably a big thing. So advocating to keep cats indoors, especially at dusk and overnight, because like I said, cats can hear bats and they can smell bats. So a bat colony is very obvious to a cat, but maybe not so obvious to us. So they know where the bats are, and they like to hunt them. It's quite fun. They actually have a pretty big impact on bat populations. The bat-friendly community guidebook that we have does list a bunch of hazards. One of the other ones that we get a lot are bats falling into rain barrels or pools. So as long as you can put a little critter catcher or some kind of escape terrain in like watering troughs or rain barrels, like just a stick or a log or a board, that anything falls in there, it can climb out. I think that is quite helpful. I think the other big thing that's happening, and this is, like I said, it's across aerial insectivores, is this loss of insect populations. So I know there's a number of groups that are all saying the same thing, is put some native plants in your backyard. Take a corner of your property and just make it your native plant corner. And lots of moths and beetles and things will pupate and use native plant species to develop on. And so if those are available, you're going to increase the food source for these bats and other aerial insectivores. So that's, I think, pretty key, actually.
Awesome. Those are some great tangible actions that folks with yards can certainly take moving forward to help out the bats.
Trying to wean people off their lawns.
Yeah. and then there's just another question specifically related to cats. So if folks maybe live in a neighborhood where neighbors have cats and they would love to put up a bat box, but the cats are a little bit out of their control, should they maybe reconsider putting up a bat box just given the proximity of cats to the...
Well, one of the recommendations is to put that box so that the bottom of the box is at least 3 meters high. And part of that is that they'll crawl to the bottom of the box, and there's like a landing pad that you build. And then they fly from that and they drop and fly. But if they're at least 3 meters up when they drop, hopefully they don't get low enough that a cat can jump up and grab them. So if you put it as high as you can, and if it's on the side of a building or on a pole, hopefully a cat can't get up there. There are other things that they have to worry about as well, but that's, for the most part, deal with that. So yeah. I think it's if in urban areas, try not to put your bat house too low, because then you're putting the bats within the reach of cats. So that's the only thing I can help you out with.
Certainly. That's good to hear. Not all hope is lost when the cats are out of your control. Perfect. Well, thank you so much, Susan. We're 15 minutes over, but there are so many great questions, and this has been a great discussion about bats. I know myself, I learned a lot. Now I'm just going to think about grizzly bears flying through the air every time I see a bat.
Exactly. Well, thank you, everyone. Thank you for coming out and learning about bats, because most people don't know anything about bats. Like, it's, like I said, like you can go through and get a PhD in biology and still know nothing about bats. So now you've listened to, for a half an hour about bats, you're a bat ambassador. So you have to go out and then teach other people about bats. And I guarantee if you just keep reading about bats, you'll be amazed, because there's so many things about bats that are amazing. And I'm biased, but it's true.
Susan, thank you so much for this incredible webinar. It was such a treat to have you on as a special guest today. I know that I learned a lot. I'm sure that everyone watching this, either live or in the recording, has learned a lot. If you would like to continue learning about bats in our community, please follow the Alberta Community Bat Program, and please make sure that you're checking them out on social media. Susan mentioned you're all bat ambassadors now, so I look forward to seeing you out there doing all that you can to help our batty little neighbors. Until our next Conservation Conversations webinar, thank you so much for attending. Looking forward to seeing you at the next one. Bye.